Howdy there, folks! Now, if you've been following my channel, you might have noted that in my review of Houseguest, I talked about how I've been a bit preoccupied lately with finishing my feature-length horror film debut, Queen Evil. I'm happy to announce that that is entering the final stages of post-production and will hopefully see a release over the next few months. As such, I can finally relax on that and take the time to get back to doing another thing that I love, and that's talking about delightfully devilish movies for you guys. I have had this pile of DVDs sitting on my fucking dresser for many years, waiting to work my way through all of them. Now that life can finally get out of the way, I could focus on talking about films like today's.
Delightfully devilish, Seymour.
Welcome back, everybody, and today we're going to be talking about the feature-length debut of one of my all-time favorite musicians, Rob Zombie. Now, some musicians have tried to branch off into filmmaking. Some experience moderate success like RZA on films such as Cutthroat City and The Man with the Iron Fists. And then some end up like Glenn Danzig, the maker of the horror film Verotica, which has been called the Room of Horror Movies. Maybe one day I'll end up talking about it. But today, we're talking about Zombie's House of a Thousand Corpses. Now, if you haven't actually seen the DVD release of this movie, it has one of those classic interactive menus you just don't find anymore. House of a Thousand Corpses is a 2003 horror film, and the first in a line of many feature-length horror movies directed by Rob Zombie, which has caused him to go on to become a very divisive figure in the horror film community. A lot of people are critical of the fact that his movies constantly feature Sherry Moon Zombie, are unoriginal, and are very mean-spirited. Whilst other people like me, we praise those movies for that exact same reason. I've seen every feature-length Rob Zombie movie to date, and I consider myself quite a fan of his work. I think Three from Hell and The Monsters were both bad films. I think 31 and The Devil's Rejects are both good films. And I think everything else he's directed lies somewhere in between, on a level of being entertaining, if not exactly great. I have no delusions about Rob Zombie as a filmmaker. I know he has a lot of limitations, but I also know he has a lot of strengths, and he very often finds the right way to play to those, which is how he's accrued a cult following amongst moviegoers. But we have to go back to the start with where it all began at House of a Thousand Corpses, and this movie had a tumultuous production history. He originally shot it in May 2000, and it was going to be released by Universal, but they backed out of the deal because they had concerns over its ratings. MGM was originally scheduled to produce it next, but after Rob Zombie made an ironic comment saying they had no morals for releasing the film, they also backed out. Eventually, Lionsgate agreed to release the film under the condition that Rob Zombie cut it down, which he did, and they ended up making back more than their investment on the first day of this movie's release, prompting them to immediately greenlight a sequel, which ended up being The Devil's Rejects. But was it worth it? Let's find out.
That mixed together.
House of a Thousand Corpses starts with Michael J. Pollard having a conversation with notorious clown Captain Spaulding over perverse matters.
Although once he got caught, you know, with a Planet of the Apes doll stuck up his asshole. Kid had Dr. Zaius stuck halfway up his butt. Couldn't get it out.
I love you, Dr. Zaius.
This quickly turns into a robbery.
Merry fucking Moses, y'all get the fuck out of here.
Clowny, keep your paws where I can see.
Yeah, don't move. I'll blast the holes the size of a Kansas City watermelon through your ugly ass bozo face!
What the fuck is that supposed to mean?
Go grab that other asshole out of the shitter and drag his ass back in here.
This guy, he says ass a lot.
You miserable motherfucker. I ought to jump over this counter and bash your fucking balls in.
Throughout this entire scene, Spaulding stands his ground, going pound for pound with smart-ass comments.
Well, I tell you what, Ski King, why don't you just take your mama home some chicken, and then I won't have to stuff my boot all up in your ass.
I don't like chicken, and I hate clowns.
Scary clown.
One.
Fuck your mama.
Two.
Fuck your sister.
Three.
Fuck your grandma.
What's your profanity?
Fuck it.
So just in case you didn't see that door opening or that other guy turning around, Rob Zombie was nice enough to repeat that for us a couple of times.
Most of all, fuck you!
He's dead.
And that is the best scene in the movie right there. I'm not saying it all goes downhill from here. I'm just saying that Sid Haig's charisma is on full display here, as is the movie's comic edge. And frankly, it starts the film off very strong. And the entire scene doesn't even actually have an impact on the narrative. If you break down a Rob Zombie film and analyze how much of the footage actually has any impact on the narrative or the characters, it's often pretty small. Sometimes it means the runtime has to be padded with music videos like the 2 minutes of intro credits in this movie. And sometimes it's just scenes of Rob Zombie letting his cast have fun. Then we're on the road with Dwight Schrute from The Office and company.
Shit, how are we almost out of gas? Jerry, how much did you put in?
I don't know, $2-3?
I told you to fill the tank.
Bill, feel me. Am I made of money?
Every time I fill up my car and I turn it on, I usually notice how much gas has been put in. I thought that was common sense, but I guess not for Dwight. You'll get a lot of transitions in this movie with inserts using inverted colors, and it can get a bit much a lot of the time.
You see, my friends and I, we're driving across country, we're writing this book, actually, on offbeat roadside attractions. You know, the crazy shit you see when you're driving across the country.
I don't drive across country.
But if you did.
But I don't.
Although that is kind of the plot of The Devil's Rejects, but I guess that hasn't happened yet, so this is still true.
I know what your problem is.
What's that?
Y'all think us folks from the country's real funny like, don't you?
Jerry?
Yeah, well, saddle up the mule, Ma. Slide me some grits. I's got to get me some education.
Jerry.
You asshole.
No, I'm really very interested. I'm not trying to make fun.
It's a bloody stitch-up.
Spalding takes the group on a museum tour, outlining a brief history of multiple serial killers, including the fictitious Dr. Satan.
They took his ass out and hung him. And that infamous hanging tree is no more than a stone's throw away from where y'all's ass is now seated.
With the boys keen to find the infamous tree, Captain Spalding points them in the right direction.
Here's your map.
Right on.
Here's your complimentary chicken.
Oh, wow.
Don't let the door hit you in the ass on the way out.
On the way, they pick up a hitchhiker who assists them on their journey.
Oh, I know. I'll show you where it's at.
If someone needs to be killed, you kill them. That's the way.
So, I mean, we were expecting her to be a killer because this scene is very obviously knocking off the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but you're just gonna give it away like that with an insert haphazardly cut in there? That's not even giving your movie a chance. And there are a lot of these shots in the film, inserts shot in Rob Zombie's basement after principal photography was completed, and they're just cut into the film at random. I'm not sure who the characters are meant to be addressing with this footage, or who's meant to be filming it, but this is just confusing if you try to think about it. On the way out, a stranger shoots out a tire.
Now my brother's got a tow truck, he can come get your car.
Oh, how convenient.
Meanwhile at the house,
how could I, being born of such conventional stock, arrive a leader of the rebellion?
The fact that the film just keeps cutting between mirrored footage and two different lighting schemes is really awkward editing, and it detracts attention away from Bill Moseley's monologue, which for the record is one that I've learned and quoted way too many times in life. Dwight goes to the house and reveals his Super Mario attire whilst Baby sends her brother to tow the others.
That's what makes it fun.
Yeah, I guess.
Nice.
Nice!
Nice.
At the house, we meet Mama Firefly, played by Karen Black.
Tonight is Halloween Eve.
So you are all invited to dinner.
But tonight, we dine in hell!
Do you know anything about the legend of Dr. Satan?
Well, I bet you'd stick your head in the fire if I told you you could see hell.
In the off chance you don't know, this is Bill Moseley, the actor who played Chop Top in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre Part 2, a film where I still maintain he should have been nominated for an Oscar for Best Supporting Actor, even though I don't give a shit about the Oscars. Oddly enough, a few people made similar comments about his performance in this film. After 12 minutes of meaningless conversation at the dinner table, we see the family perform stand-up comedy and a lip-sync number which lasts another 5 minutes whilst Rob Zombie's editing style gets even more music video-like in a seeming effort to distract audiences from the lack of story progression. There is a lot of moments where multiple shots are cropped into a single frame, and whilst this technique was used very well in Brian De Palma's filmography, here it's just a distraction.
I said get the fuck off him, you stupid fucking whore! Fucking slut!
Will you watch your ruddy language? My ears are not a toilet.
I'll fucking cut your tits off and shove them down your throat!
Okay, that line hits way too close to home for me because an almost identical threat was made against a member of my family once by my first stepmother. I'm calling her my first stepmother because that ultimately led to her getting divorced.
Car's done.
Oh good, so the story can start moving again, right?
Wrong.
After driving no distance, the family decides to assault and kidnap them all in a frantic series of blue-filtered quick cuts. They even start to destroy the car, contrary to the fact that one of them literally just repaired it. This plot point I've never understood. They blew out one of the tires with a gun so they could disable them and lead them into the house, then repaired the car, led them out of the house, destroyed the car again, and kidnapped them again.
That does not make sense.
Also, now that they've been kidnapped and are about to be subject to whatever violence and torture comes next, I'm just gonna say this. The story completely stops moving here. This is where House of a Thousand Corpses starts to rely strictly on its genre gimmicks. And don't get me wrong, the violence, the chemistry between cast members and all that, it's a fun time. But if you want story, want it somewhere else.
Listen, you Malibu middle-class Barbie piece of shit, I'm trying to work here. Work? You ever work? Yeah, I'll bet you have. Scooping ice cream to your shit-heel friends on summer break. Well, I ain't talking about no goddamn white socks with Mickey Mouse on one side and Donald Duck on the other. I ain't reading no funny books, Mama.
You'll say anything, won't you? Words don't mean a thing to you, do they?
Why are you doing this to me? Why are you doing this?
Why? 'Cause fuck 'em, that's why.
You don't know what kind of dry spell I've had here. Total block! Total block!
Movie references.
Oh, my brain is burning! Non-flashback! Non-flashback! Oh!
While Otis B. Driftwood shows how he turned Dwight into a fish boy, two cops, including a young Walton Goggins, go to Captain Spaulding's in search for the kids.
You seen this girl, say, in the last 24 hours?
yeah, cute kid. Ain't my type, though. You know, I like him with a little more meat on him. The bigger the cushion, the sweeter the pushing.
Wow, you really are disgusting.
Hey, poopy pants, what's new?
I like to think that's how former Prime Minister Scott Morrison's wife likes to greet him. Following a long slow motion dream sequence, which has been entirely filtered by negative colors, the cops and the father of one of the girls go to the house to investigate. But a whole lot of footage, which clearly once featured dialogue, gets trimmed into a montage of slow motion and crossfades where all three are executed whilst I Remember You by Frank Ifield is playing.
I'm waiting.
How long is this going to take?
That shot was 25 seconds of complete silence before I even pulled the trigger. And frankly, it's one of the most obnoxiously long slow motion shots I've ever seen in a movie. It almost gives Zack Snyder a run for his money. Almost.
Well, I don't think they require assless chaps, okay?
Where's Otis?
He's not in his cell.
I shot him.
Well, that's... What?
After killing this girl's father, Otis cuts his face off, puts it on, and then kisses her.
That is some pretty fucked up shit.
Can you say what the fuck did I do last night?
The family takes them out into the fields. One of them runs off into the woods only for Baby to chase her down and stab her to death. The two survivors are placed into a coffin and lowered into an underground cavern where the dude is taken away by the failed experiment of Dr. Satan. Final Girl wanders around a cavern full of countless dead bodies, or if you will, a house of a thousand corpses.
He said it!
Eventually, she finds Dr. Satan performing vivisection on the other guy. Then suddenly, we're apparently watching Terminator as a Mechano-Man makes cyber noises chasing the final girl back through the grave tunnel. In a frantic series of quick cuts and tedious slow motion, Zombinator acts as a support beam, causing the tunnel to collapse on him before she crawls to freedom and then gets picked up by Captain Spaulding.
What a twist.
Oh! Bitch got me again, motherfucker! Not again!
And then the movie just ends. Now for the record, I was not haphazard in recounting the plot of House of a Thousand Corpses because there's actually very little to go there, but is it a good movie?
I enjoy it.
I had originally planned for this to be the first in a line of three movie reviews about the entire Firefly trilogy. But after watching them, I realized there's actually not enough for me to talk about there, so I'll just briefly express my sentiments. The Devil's Rejects is easily Rob Zombie's finest film. It's the cast of House of a Thousand Corpses in a more sadistic version of Bonnie and Clyde, and the collection of charismatic, mean-spirited characters in a Sam Peckinpah-style modern-day western makes for an intense experience. And that should have been where the series ended, but despite that movie ending with, spoiler alert, a massive shootout where everyone was left for dead, they managed to recover. How? Somehow, they returned. Free From Hell had some decent qualities, such as having the three battle a gang of Mexican criminals, but the entire film felt wholly unnecessary from the get-go, and the story was arguably the least original of any zombie film. And that is really saying something from the film director, who pretty much remade the Texas Chainsaw Massacre with this movie, as well as crossing it over with elements from The Hills Have Eyes. Free From Hell failed to breathe any new life into the franchise or give a substantial character to Richard Brake, who was perfect as always. Rob Zombie was put into a very difficult position making Free From Hell, because just prior to finally getting shooting off the ground, Sid Haig fell incredibly ill and his role had to be cut down to nothing more than a glorified cameo before a role for Richard Brake was written. Unfortunately, the absence of Sid Haig is felt incredibly, and Richard Brake, whilst awesome, his character is just so lame. Foxy Coltrane, he is the most boring member of the Firefly family. And for an actor who is as good in horror movies as Richard Brake is to be playing such a dull, lifeless, thin character, that is probably the biggest letdown of Free From Hell. The Devil's Rejects is a good film. Free From Hell is a bad film. But only House of a Thousand Corpses meets the criteria of being just good and just bad enough for me to want to talk about it here. When I first watched House of a Thousand Corpses in 2017, I was underwhelmed. I expected something more gonzo from the metal icon, and what I got was a dose of reality. The feature-length debut of a music video director whose ambition far exceeds his grasp and has obviously collided with studio interference. Make no mistake, House of a Thousand Corpses is a fun time, but it's also a big showcase for the immaturity of the first-time director. If you compare this movie to The Devil's Rejects, it is obvious to most people which is the objectively superior film. For all its flaws, The Devil's Rejects is a way more refined, competent, and mature film made by a director who has obviously learned from trial and error. Zombie has actually gone on to call House of a Thousand Corpses a calamitous mess, and when he watches it, he says he only sees flaw upon flaw upon flaw. Whilst it is obviously an affectionate homage to the horror films of the 70s, it's also tremendously derivative of those. Zombie makes no attempt to disguise this, telling a story which is thoroughly predictable the entire time, with protagonists who have no semblance of character or real likability to them, minus Rainn Wilson, whose natural charisma led into a much bigger career following this movie. And since there is so little story, Zombie is left relying on the talents of his actors to actually carry the movie. They do a tremendous job, but they unfortunately do not disguise the obvious shortcomings in the film's script. The other key problem with the film is it is overwhelmed by style. Zombie cuts this film together like a feature-length music video, with several scenes feeling like actual music videos just designed to pad the running time. House of a Thousand Corpses is a mirage of neon lighting, quick cuts, confusing VHS inserts, inserts from other movies, prolonged slow motion, mirrored split screens, excessive use of color filters and negative imaging, crossfades and zooms clearly added in post-production. And a lot of this is pretty to look at in spots, but when there's so much of it and so little narrative to go with it, the appeal of the gimmicks easily wear off. Personally, I would like to see Rob Zombie take the footage for this movie, including all the more gory and sexual stuff that had to be cut, and re-edit it in the modern day from a more mature perspective. When Sylvester Stallone did that and released the director's cut of Rocky IV, he made a much superior film which still had everything that made the original movie great. I sincerely believe Rob Zombie could do the same thing if he released a new cut of this movie. Unfortunately, all the information on the web suggests that that is gonna be a long time waiting if it ever ends up happening. Despite all its good features, as a whole, I really can't say I consider House of a Thousand Corpses to be objectively a good film. But when you look at it from a subjective perspective, I find a lot to appreciate about it. And that's because this is the kind of movie that Walter Hill described making when he made Bullet to the Head. We're not breaking new ground, we're trying to entertain within a format that's familiar. That's exactly what Rob Zombie tries to do here, and as a hardcore diehard horror movie fan, I can certainly say there has never been a single time watching this movie that I have not been entertained. Despite the stylistic setbacks, the film does go a very long way on a relatively small budget. It isn't as violent as the title might make you think, but it's got a solid level of blood, gore, and general sadism nonetheless, as well as a consistent sense of black comedy, which makes for a much more fun experience. Zombie also recognizes that horror fans are way more likely to be interested in the personalities of the horror villains than heroes, and as such, he devotes a lot of attention to giving the audience time to spend with the Firefly family, who have deservedly gone on to become horror icons. So much of my appreciation for this film comes down to the casting of Bill Moseley, a horror icon who now has his own action figure as a result of appearing in these movies. Bill Moseley never got to experience the same level of popularity and success that he found in playing Chop Top until he was cast as Otis B. Driftwood. And the fact that he saw the man's talent and cast him in a role that reinvigorated his career gives me so much respect for him. Moseley is over the top, unpredictable, and psychotic, yet always in control. His line delivery is a solid balance between dramatic sadism and black comedy, and even his overall appearance is iconic. Moseley is given a long overdue chance to shine in this movie, and to see Chop Top brought back for a new generation with a whole new character worthy of his talents is one of the key reasons I keep coming back and watching this movie. Bill Moseley's talent actually inspired an independent campaign to get him nominated for an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor for his performance in the sequel, The Devil's Rejects.
That's good.
And yet, despite his short screen time, veteran actor Sid Haig challenges Moseley to be the real star of this movie. Almost all their scenes are separate, which keeps the momentum of their different narrative points running, but Sid Haig gives the movie its best moment with the opening robbery scene. Whilst less sadistic than his counterpart in this film, Haig is way funnier. He's terrifying and hilarious, like a scary clown should be, and nobody commands attention in this movie nearly as well as he does. Sid Haig once made the mistake of turning down the role of Marcellus Wallace in Pulp Fiction, a decision he has always regretted. However, that would have been one of many things that led him to eventually taking on the role of Captain Spaulding in House of a Thousand Corpses, and he just fucking shines. The man has been a legendary actor for decades, and yet he will always be Captain Spaulding to me. If you check out The Devil's Rejects, he gets a lot more screen time and he gets to be a whole lot more dark and vindictive. 70s icon Karen Black is also in the film, and she's an interesting casting choice. She is an Oscar-nominated Hollywood icon, and yet despite all her solid performances in Easy Rider, Five Easy Pieces, Airport 75, The Day of the Locust, she will always be Mama Firefly to me. She is everything the character should be. And it is really disappointing Karen Black didn't come back for the sequel, unfortunately. And then there's Sherry Moon Zombie, who has consistently been open about the fact that she has never had any aspirations to become a real actress. If you look at her filmography, outside of Rob Zombie's works, she's appeared in almost nothing. Amongst her detractors, there is actually a big divide between those who dislike her simply for not being a great actress, and those who dislike Rob Zombie for always casting his wife, calling him every toxic masculine insult from simp to cuck. I gotta say, you pretty much see the extent of her acting abilities in this film, but as for her casting goes, I couldn't give a fuck. She is psychotic, she is an over-the-top mix of a sadistic serial killer and a Barbie movie, and frankly, I think within the limitations of what Rob Zombie has in fact written, I think she fucking kills it. The only time I've ever disliked Sherry Moon Zombie as an actress were in the two Rob Zombie films I didn't enjoy. In The Munsters, despite her campy efforts, she didn't even come close to capturing the spirit of Lily Munster, the same way Jeff Daniel Phillips was no Herman Munster. And Free From Hell was her real low point because the script for that film was so weak that Baby Firefly's gimmicks had gotten pretty annoying when there wasn't a decent film to back them up. But in House of a Thousand Corpses, I think she's fine. She's less remarkable than the more seasoned actors around her, but she's energetic, violent, and sadistic, which all works perfectly well in the universe of a Rob Zombie movie. Her level of over-the-top energy contrasts very well from the personalities of the other killers around her. So I think she makes a very solid addition to the team of killers. Also, yes, she's drop-dead sexy, and neither her nor the director are afraid to show that off. With a cast and director who seem to be having such a fun time exploring the universe of this film, even with all its limitations, that energy is so infectious that it keeps me coming back and wanting to watch this movie again and again. That gives it great rewatch value. And for me, the number one important quality in a good movie is the rewatch value. Sure, some of the greatest films ever made, you can maybe only watch once or twice because they're a certain kind of experience, but the kind of movies I personally enjoy more than others are the kinds I can watch 100,000 times. I've seen House of a Thousand Corpses nearly 10 times, I think, and every time it has done the job. But one of the key things that I really appreciate in this movie is the fact that it shows so much of the flair that Rob Zombie would later develop into making his much better movies. You can see his affection for the early films of Tobe Hooper and Wes Craven. Zombie is visibly indebted to his favorite filmmakers and makes no effort to disguise it, both to the joy of horror fans and the detriment to the film's originality. But for his debut feature, you can see that all the pieces of a solid filmmaker are in fact there. They're just very much let down by inexperience this time around. Rob Zombie would later go on to direct the divisive remake of the slasher classic Halloween, directed by John Carpenter, whom I personally consider to be the greatest filmmaker of all time because all his movies have such great rewatch value, even the lesser ones. But if you go back to his feature-length debut on the movie Dark Star, there is a lot of elements there that I see in Rob Zombie with this movie. Originally a 45-minute student film, Carpenter was given additional funding to expand Dark Star to feature-length, turning it from, quote, the most impressive student film into the least impressive professional film. Dark Star is a wonderful low-budget satire of 2001 A Space Odyssey. It has many obvious budgetary limitations, but it shows the flair that Carpenter would later become so famous for as a director. And I think the same can be said about House of a Thousand Corpses. Whilst much bigger in budget and more commercial, it displays what Rob Zombie can do with a mere $7 million budget and serves as a precursor to what he would later do with more experience. This is Rob Zombie's Dark Star, and looking at it from the perspective of a filmmaker, there's something really liberating about watching these movies. Both House of a Thousand Corpses and Dark Star show these filmmakers at their roots, making mistakes, struggling with limitations, yet so determined to tell a story that they push through it. And you can really feel the passion in that. For me, I found that very liberating to watch from the perspective of a filmmaker because for the past 3 years, I've been trying to get my own feature film made. It's finally about to come out, which is dope. And yet there was a night in 2022 when I was feeling particularly anxious about a lot of the mistakes I made in filming and a lot of the things that I could have done better. That same night, whilst on psychedelics, I ended up watching Dark Star. And I loved it in a way I had never really appreciated before because I could see all the limitations. I could see all the little mistakes made that John Carpenter would later go on to not make again with his later films. And I saw a good movie. Frankly, that made me realize that my first film is going to be my Dark Star, is going to be my House of a Thousand Corpses. It's going to be where I show my flair as a filmmaker and yet where I make more mistakes than I'll probably ever make on another film. So say what you want about either of those movies because there's a lot of fair ground to criticize there. But it's hard to deny that there's a lot of passion in both movies, and it's hard to deny that they show filmmakers working not in their prime, but just starting off and working towards it. As a final note, I want to tell you about the best viewing experience I've ever had with this movie. In 2022, me and two friends got together and decided to watch the Erwin Keyes trilogy, three movies that featured bit part actor Erwin Keyes, starting with The Warriors, going on to House of a Thousand Corpses, and finishing with Black Dynamite. Together, those three films made up less than 4.5 hours in runtime. We went from a 70s action thriller to a 70s-inspired horror film to a 70s-inspired action comedy. And it was actually one of the best viewing experiences I've ever had with a number of movies. I honestly can't recommend that enough. So if you want a good experience watching House of a Thousand Corpses, watch it with Erwin Keyes' other films. House of a Thousand Corpses gets 5 acts of necrophilia out of 10. It's often overwhelmed by style and underdeveloped in the script department, leading to it dragging on at times. And yet, with impassioned direction from Rob Zombie and a gonzo cast of characters, you've got an energetic, mean-spirited horror film, which is as sadistic as it is downright silly and aware of it. And that goes for today's episode of Delightfully Devilish, you guys. If you have any movies you want to see me discuss on this show, please leave them in the comment section below. If you want to check the links, you'll see the trailer for Queen Evil, and you'll see the link to the Facebook page where I occasionally post updates about it. I'm hoping to get on top more of that. In the meantime, I've been your host, Jukebox Harry. Thanks for watching. Peace.